another wonderful meal. Thank you very much for the organizers who found our great chef. It's the time to remember that great mathematics has often been created over food and drink. Historically, it's a great thing to look at. We could just talk about Kepler's wine bottles, which predated calculus, of course. James York, our speaker this afternoon, is the Distinguished University Professor of Mathematics and Physics at the University of Maryland, College Park, and currently chair of the Mathematics Department, where he also earned his own doctoral degree. Believing a PhD in mathematics is a license to investigate the universe. He does this with a broad research program, which includes analysis of genomes, dynamics of computer networks, and population dynamics of HIV. Dr. York has a special way with words. 35 years ago, working with a colleague, he coined the mathematical term chaos. Today, some of his chaos projects focus on topics with other interesting words. One is weather prediction. Another is looking at shadows to understand reality. And one which may directly connect to food, the dynamics of a taffy flea machine. Dr. York.
Delighted to be here. I have to how to get the projector on. Does anybody know?
Oh.
There should be a remote
wait,
control.
Yeah, they were out, the AD people were right out there.
I got started in chaos. My collaborator and I coined the term chaos as a mathematical term. Terms at that time that were being used were commuting diagrams and axiom A and axiom B and transversality and all kinds of meaningless things that are meaningless. Chaos is not a meaningless word to you. And the message is that basically chaos in scientific systems is what we think of as chaos around the world in a lot of ways. There are movies on sensitivity to initial data. Sliding Doors with Gwyneth Paltrow, 2002, is a story. It's a Broadway form in which they run through a story twice. Gwyneth Paltrow is the character, is running for a subway door, and in one case, the door closes before she gets there. In the other case, she gets through the door. They then follow the evolution in two different paths. See, a tiny change produces a big change. You don't have to learn chaos theory to know that. Run, Lola, Run goes one better. It goes through the same story three times. It's a German top of the line. And different events occur. And Ray Bradbury came up with a story in which then the Simpsons got onto, where I guess Bart Simpson perhaps goes back in time and steps on a butterfly. And then he comes back forwards and there are donuts raining from the sky. Well, they get carried away. And everything has changed completely because of this little change back then. And actually, Ray Bradbury's story was a very little change. It's only slight changes, which seems a little bit strange. So Lorenz, in 1979, wrote a paper, he talks about this, a flap of a butterfly's wing in Brazil set off a tornado in Texas. Did he create that concept? No. This is a little story I think we've all heard. And what you're getting here is a more sophisticated version, because you're seeing the levels of complexity, where one of a nail is a lot simpler, a lot less important than losing a shoe, of a horseshoe. And then you lose the horse, and then the rider, but it's unclear which is more important. There's a transition back long time ago. The wars were huge numbers of soldiers carrying knives and such, and very few horses, because horses were more valuable than the warriors. In any case, Benjamin Franklin wrote a version of this. This is not Benjamin Franklin's. He adopted an earlier one, and he improved it. And in his version, it didn't go as much as a kingdom was lost. But why not? So you see, this is sensitivity to initial data. A small change, a nail being lost, could, in principle, cause the battle being lost. What you have here is exponential growth in change as a result of that. As a result of that nail being lost. If you want, I was talking to a young lady one time. I asked her how her parents met. And she said, well, her mother took a taxi and wound up marrying the taxi driver. Now, if she'd taken a different taxi, where would this young lady be? If you want to take this personally, when you were conceived, some sperm hit an egg. What happens if a different sperm had hit and you came out exactly the same, except the different sex, the other sex, right? Whichever one you are. Just imagine, this little change producing a huge change. And chaos is not about that happening once, but the fact that it keeps on happening. This is something from the Washington Post about the butterfly is threatening to cause tornadoes, so she steps on the butterfly and says it was self-defense. Okay, so there are basically three kinds of behavior in scientific systems, or relatively simple systems, where one is steady state. And you might take, for example, this table. Or we can take any object we want. Okay, here is something, a bag. Now, sir, can you tell me how high above the table this is?
2 feet.
Plus or minus?
One.
Plus or minus 1 foot. Okay. Now, gotta let it go. Boom. How far is above the table?
Zero.
Plus or minus?
Zero.
Fair enough. Now what we've seen, that in this first type, our steady state chaos, what actually has happened is that we're not seeing a big divergence. We consider two different initial states, one where it's on the table, and one where it's above the table. We ignore transient. See, the transient is the one that's falling down to the table. Of course, life is a transient. You cannot ignore the transients. Nonetheless, now, imagine what happens in any case is that these two different possible states as to where that thing is are not diverging from each other. They're steady state. They're not moving. Now imagine I had two watches, my hands going around, and suppose one ran about a minute faster than the other, and you start them off equal in time. A day later, there's a periodic motion, periodic cycling of these hands. A day later, they're a minute different. Okay. After 2 days, they're 2 minutes different. After 3 days, they're 3 minutes different. After 30 days, they're 30 minutes different. it's a very mild divergence. So periodic is mild divergence. Quasi-periodic means, for example, you look at the standard idea of the solar system where the Earth is periodically going around the sun and the moon is going around with a totally different period around the Earth and Jupiter is going around the sun with a 12.1-year period, roughly. And all these periodic motions are combined. In fact, the solar system is more complicated than that. To see that the solar system is more complicated than that, things change in the solar system. For example, Halley's Comet comes by every 74 years, is it? Or 76?
26-1.
Slow down. Okay. So in any case, every time it comes by, it burns off a lot of its mass. A significant part, in any case. It can't have been doing this for a million years. It would have, unless it started out the side of a very huge object. And comets are not huge objects. Therefore, what we've seen is somehow it has entered into its current orbit, and its current orbit will allow it only to persist for a limited amount of time. Somehow, its original orbit completely changed. Things can happen. Numerical simulations of the orbits of Mercury and of the planets indicate there's about a 1% chance that in the next billion years, Mercury and Venus could either collide or switch orbits, or maybe one of them would be kicked out of the solar system. That would be Mercury because it's smaller. And so you've got all these different kinds of complicated motions that can occur. So it isn't really quasi-periodic. That if you go back in time, there was more stuff in the solar system, and with time, stuff has been kicked out of the solar system. And only the relatively stable motions persist. So now, here's a mathematical version. I thought I should give you a mathematical version of a process. And imagine we have an angle. We're going to measure angles from 0 around to 1. Okay? So one revolution, so we're measuring them in revolutions. One third of the way around would be somewhere around here. And if we start with something like 1/3, 0.33, what we do here is we throw away the integer number of revolutions. We only keep in track of the fractions, where it is around a circle. Okay? That's mod 1. That's what that means. And so the next iterate is 0.66. It's doubled, right? Everybody agree with that. 1.32, so somewhere it's here, and then it comes. So this is 0.66, and then 1.32 is around pretty close to where it started. 0.64, that goes to 1.28, which we throw in 1. 0.56, 0.12, okay? Now, perhaps I misled you when I said we take a number like a third. Is 0.33 like a third? That's the question. And in chaos, the answer is no. Because you start with a third, and we follow that, we get 2/3, which goes to 4/3, throw away the integer part, we get a third. Now we're back to where we started. This is a deterministic system, it'll just keep on repeating forever. Now, these two numbers differ by one part in 300. Remember how the clocks diverged from each other, linearly. What happens here is that on the second iterate, it's doubled. On the third iterate, it's doubled because we're doubling the angle. So the difference in the angles doubles. So you're down here to 64 parts. Next one is 128. And after that, you have no information. So if you started with an angle somewhere between here and here, you'd have no information about it after 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 iterates. Okay? That's qualitatively different. This is a qualitatively different phenomenon, and that's why it's got a different name from these periodic motions. If you look back in the textbooks of the 70s in physics, there was no chaos. People only wanted things they could write down the solutions to in closed form. hey, that's more educational, it's better for the students. We only give them problems, we write down how to solve them. If you can write it down in closed form, it isn't chaotic. Such closed form solutions do not support. This is not closed form. I'm just writing down what these solutions are and telling you what the numerics are. Let's go on to a different exhibition of chaos. Chaos was first system was really demonstrated to be chaotic if you ignore Benjamin Franklin and the movie makers. Well, in any case, back in 1890, Poincaré entered a contest, scientific contest, and the problem was sponsored by the King Gustav of Norway and Sweden. And the question was, can you prove the solar system is stable? Okay. Well, I've told you the solar system is not stable because you can lose planets. And Poincaré won the prize. He had a very simple solar system. He had a three-body solar system, so it'd be something like the Earth, Mercury, and Venus. That'd be a simple solar system. But after he won the prize, before it was actually in print, a mathematician started questioning the details. Can you explain this little point, Henri? No. Well, so in any case, they figured out that the paper was wrong. And they said, okay, go back, keep the prize, go back, it's already been awarded, go back, write us a paper that's correct. And in the process, he decided that we have three-body problems, that they can behave chaotically. Okay. Now, here, this is actually a restricted three-body problem, and that approximately, we have the Earth and the Moon, and we have a spacecraft. So the spacecraft essentially has nearly zero mass. It isn't going to affect significantly the orbits of the Moon or the Earth. Now, the Sun is playing a role in here, and this is a rotating coordinate system. So you imagine you're above the solar system taking a movie of what's going on. And as the Earth goes around the Sun, you rotate the camera so it looks like the Earth and Moon are fixed. Okay? And so the question was, spacecraft implementation has played a role similar to football, where the idea is to win. Certainly that's the goal of going to the moon. When John Kennedy set the goal of going to the moon, it was to beat the Russians. So in any case, the United States wanted to be the first nation to send a spacecraft to a comet. Halley's Comet was coming by. And spacecraft were being built by the Europeans and Japan, I believe. And the United States didn't have any money committed to building a spacecraft. So it makes it a little bit hard to win this battle, doesn't it? Well, it turns out that there was another comet coming by, even earlier. And so if you picture the orbit of the Earth going around the Sun, the Jacobini-Zinner comet was going to pierce the plane close to the Earth's orbit. But when it pierced that plane close to the Earth's orbit, it would be 60 million miles away from where the Earth actually was. So in this picture, you got to get the spacecraft, an existing space, they decided to use an existing spacecraft. And they wanted to get it 60 million miles from this picture. They had to get it, move it out. Now, Robert Farquhar, who was a NASA contractor, figured out that they had this spacecraft, which had played a number of roles. It had 200 pounds of fuel on it. Now, you usually don't think about space missions starting with 200 pounds of fuel. nonetheless, that's what they had. And it was basically reporting on the solar wind and such. And if they had parked it at this point, it would balance, basically, between the Earth and the Sun. I'm ignoring the slight variations in the orbit of the Earth. So it would balance at this point, but any radio signals it sent out towards the Earth would be drowned out by the much stronger radio signals coming from the Sun. Therefore, it was the Hale orbit. And as the Earth goes around, the Hale orbit is actually out of the plane. Details you don't need to know. So in 1982, this is where it was. And he figured out a way of getting this spacecraft, using only 200 pounds of fuel, to go through the tail of the comet. They didn't want to hit the comet. In view of its abilities, going through the tail of the comet is what they really needed. And so he figured out an orbit, and they actually implemented this orbit. So they made a change in velocity of 10 miles an hour. Now, just keep in mind, this is my bicycling speed. And so they launched it. See, this was an unstable orbit. This Hale orbit was unstable. It could either fall towards the Sun or fall towards the Earth. And they made a push in just the right direction to come in like so. Okay, now, here it goes in front of the moon. The moon is going around this way. It goes in front of the moon. The moon, it's getting pulled by the moon. The moon is moving this way. It actually loses energy. The spacecraft loses energy if it goes in front of the moon. If it goes behind the moon, it gains energy. So that this is a near pass of the moon. And now here's the second near pass of the moon. It goes behind the moon, and it gets accelerated again. They're trying to jockey this spacecraft into the right position. They figured out all this in advance. And so now it goes through another one of these loops, and now it goes in front of the moon again and slows down. And it goes in front of the, behind the moon and gets accelerated, pass number four. Now, these passes from here to here take 3/4 of a month, because that's how long it takes the moon to get around here. But these loops out here take several months. And here's a spot number five. They had to get to go 100 miles from the surface of the moon behind the moon. So this is behind the moon 2 times in a row, so they're trying to gain as much energy as they can. And so it goes behind the moon, missing the moon by 100 miles. And this is actually sending it into the Sun, which would not, if you actually follow the orbit out further, it goes through the back near the Earth's orbit. And they actually had it go through the tail of the comet, and it was a successful mission. Now this is using chaos, the chaos in the three-body problem, to give you a lot of possibilities of the motion of this little rock, this spacecraft. At the same time, you would be justified in saying, well, what would happen if instead of giving it a 10-mile-an-hour push here, they gave it a 10.01-mile-an-hour push, and in fact, the spacecraft, this is the hardest thing to control accurately, exact burst of fuel, then they would have gone through a little bit of this, but sooner or later, because of the chaos, the exponential divergence of trajectories, they would diverge exponentially, and the spacecraft would not have gotten anywhere near where it was supposed to go. So, is this really a chaotic system? It certainly is, because here you can see this coming in here, it goes behind the moon, and you can see the actual change in the angle. Here, these other ones are further from the moon, so if it go on the other side of the moon, which is only 2,160 miles in diameter, it would have come down at this sharper angle. And then so in any case, you've got a lot of possibilities. The point is they had 200 pounds of fuel, and they used this fuel to make many orbit corrections so they could put it back on this intended path. The really remarkable thing about this is there was no video camera of any kind on this, and they had to figure out where the spacecraft was just from judging from the radio signals. That I don't know how they did, but. So this is called the restricted three-body problem. And if you think only in terms of the kinetic energy of the spacecraft, it is not preserved. And the kinetic energy of the moon and the Earth are changed so slightly there'd be no way to directly measure it. What happens is that it can gain kinetic plus potential energy, total energy, if it also gains angular momentum. And it can lose total energy if it also loses angular momentum. And if they lose both, it depends on the coordinates you use. Here there's an equality if you use just the right coordinate system. Otherwise there's a constant proportionality you have to use. And this is often used in sending spacecraft. You may want to send the spacecraft to the outer solar system, they will send it first to Venus, where it goes behind Venus and gets an extra kick. It comes back towards the Earth and gets an extra kick, and then it goes out without using any fuel for that. So it can have considerable gains in energy. So that's an example of chaos. There's also chaos that can be hidden in systems, which look quite stable. And I want to tell you about a pendulum. Let me tell you about this pendulum. Now this pendulum is just barely hanging on here. This is a pendulum hanging from a pendulum. Okay? And standard way of describing this in the 70s would have been to say, well, for low amplitude oscillations, you have two modes of oscillation, and one of they're periodic motions, and here is one of the periodic motions, more or less. So the two pendulums are swinging together. If you want to see, come on up, because this is going to go on for a few minutes here. Come on up, we've got chairs up, we've got an entire empty table. Or stand up, or whatever you want. Find this, see if you can find a way through. That's the tricky part. Okay, so here, got a couple chairs for people. Come on up. Go around to the outer door if you want. There's a competition here. Now you have to be close up to play the game reasonably. So, what we have here is the other mode of oscillation is where the two pendulums are going in different directions, and in fact the periods are quite different of those two motions, where they swing together or where they swing oppositely. But in fact you don't have to restrict yourself to small amplitude oscillations, so they would say that small amplitude oscillations are combinations of those two, linear combinations of those two behaviors. And making sure we're all clear here. Okay, so if we were to give it motion like this, you see it's got completely different kinds of motion, which are unlike those two periodic motions. This is not a periodic motion. It's basically chaotic. You see, your eyes are seeing this and making predictions, and then you see that. I keep on doing that. I don't know. Interesting. Never seen do such an extreme thing. So in any case, start up again and see. And I want to play a game with you where we look at this and we try to decide, you try to predict, you saw it initially, well, is that going to go or not? Well, in any case, it looks as though the red one is no longer going through the silver one, right? And so your goal is to try to predict when that'll happen, okay? So it's everybody against everybody else, except the guys in the back who can't see what's going on. And the way you're supposed to tell me that you think that the red one has stopped going through the silver one is that. That is your way of communicating to everybody your prediction. Chaos is about prediction. It's hard to predict. Okay? So, that's the name of the game. I want everybody to try, first of all. Test the concept. Put your pencils down, please. Ready? Who's got to try again? Everybody's got to try again. Okay, now, you get two tries. Okay? So if you're wrong the first time, you get a second shot. I tried this once in Japan. Nobody would ever. You wouldn't be wrong.
It's when the red one that's going through the.
What?
It's when the red one.
When you think the red one will no longer go through the silver one. At any point, you can clap. But if it then goes through the silver one, then you're wrong and you get one more try. Okay? Okay. So try this. See, we couldn't play this with the bag I showed you, which I dropped. You'd everybody know when it's going to hit and stop. So these things are hard to call. Somebody else.
Fine, clap. Yeah, I think it still has it.
External influence. Okay, so who you two, would you please stand up and come over here?
Here.
Well, it's a test, you see, because somebody had to win, right? And maybe this is skill. And so it's everybody against this team. I tried this in my class last week, and the same team won two times in a row. So we don't know if... Okay, so... Are you ready? Okay.
Now it's one of the normal modes.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's in virtually one of the normal modes.
Right.
Doesn't have any advantage to do it anymore.
Looks like it has quit. It's hard to tell when it's got enough energy because the first time we stopped it, it had a large amount of energy and quit. So who won? Okay, so that team won. Try once more against the evil team. See, if this thing was really chaotic and had no friction, we'd have to throw it out because we couldn't play the game. But in fact, it runs down, so it's not really chaotic. Chaos is something which persists an arbitrarily long amount of time. Yeah, well, I was like that other mode, but
yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Oh, no.
You're wiggling the podium.
No, actually,
look at your thumb off the scale.
It's forcing function on the podium.
Okay, how did you guys do that time?
There were several who thought
it. Okay, so in any case, let's give these guys a chance. Chaos is all about predictability. So.